Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio this afternoon is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letter R in the chat function during the relevant question. I would again make a plea for short and succinct questions and answers to match in order to get in as many members as possible. Question number one, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the reported ongoing political instability within the UK Government impacts on the timing of its plans to ask the constitutional question of whether Scotland should be an independent country.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
UK Government policies are making major economic challenges such as inflation, inequality and the cost of living crisis worse. Instability and uncertainty are increasing as financial markets express a lack of confidence in the UK Government's economic management and competence. Scotland has an abundance of skilled people, innovative businesses and natural resources. We have everything it takes to be just as successful as comparable independent European countries. Independence is essential to build a stronger economy, a more just society and a Scotland that works for everyone, for this and future generations. We are fully committed to holding an independence referendum in October next year, pending the decision of the Supreme Court.
Karen Adam, supplementary.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. With Liz Truss having become Prime Minister with the backing of just 80,000 voters and now Rishi Sunak coordinated by a cluster of Tory MPs, the Conservative Party's democratic mandate is becoming more and more diluted. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me then that the Tories have no leg to stand on when they question the Scottish Government's cast iron mandate to hold an independence referendum next year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank Karen Adam for that supplementary. The Scottish Government will certainly not take any lectures from a party that has not won a single national election in Scotland since the 1950s. There was a Scottish Parliament election last year. A record number of members of this chamber were elected on a manifesto commitment that the people should be able to take their view on Scotland's constitutional future as an independent country. We still live in a democratic state. The people have had their say. The people's decision should be respected and they should have a vote next autumn on Scotland's independent future. And I would advise those parties that are pursuing this argument of democracy denial is they really, really should give up on it.
I have three supplementaries. I intend to take each of them. Supplementary from Donald Cameron.
Cabinet Secretary, the question mentions political instability. Isn't the truth that the only threat to the political stability of the United Kingdom is the Scottish Government's blinkered commitment to a divisive, polarising referendum which is creating uncertainty for people and businesses across Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Donald Cameron's making the mistake of rereading his election leaflets from last year, when that was the position of the Scottish Conservative Party. The position of the Scottish National Party and the Scottish Green Party was that the people should have their say in a referendum. His party lost the election and the SNP and the Greens won the election. We form a government in this place. A majority of MSPs wish the people to have a say in a referendum. So long as we live in a democracy, we should act on the wishes of the electorate. It's a shame that some parties in this chamber don't believe that as well.
Supplementary, Sarah Boyett.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I agree with the Cabinet Secretary that the Tories have created massive inequalities and divisions, but won't he accept that our focus in Scotland now should be tackling the cost of living crisis, not replicating that division and wasting £20 million in a referendum that people simply don't want?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I referred Sarah Boyack to the answer I gave a moment ago. She was elected to this place opposing a referendum on Scotland's future, but a majority of MSPs were elected to do that. It's not an either-or question. Yes, we need to deal with the social and economic challenges, in particular those that are being exacerbated by the UK Tory party. But the idea that we should somehow park democracy while that takes place is misguided and wrong. We should, as Democrats, deliver on what the public has voted for and not block democratic choice.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
By their own admission, an independent Scotland would be using the currency of a foreign country with no influence over its economic policy. For at least 10 years, we'd be outside both the UK and the EU single markets. Is that not the case, that the Scottish Government's plans for independence would repeat the mistakes of Liz Truss's economic plans rather than learn those lessons?
Cabinet Secretary.
I could just simply answer the question by saying no, but I'd go on to make the point that I've made in this chamber a number of times before. It is not a liberal, nor is it a democratic position to block democratic votes on the constitutional future of a country. I understand that the Liberal Democrats in Scotland would prefer power to be exercised over Scotland's future at Westminster. I understand that. We have a different view on that. Can we not be agreed as Democrats that when the public elects a parliament on a manifesto commitment that there should be a referendum, as Democrats, at least we should agree that a referendum should take place? Then we can have the substantive debate and discussion about the different policy questions. I would, even at this late stage, appeal to the Liberal Democrats to re-examine their liberalism and their belief in democracy, because at the present time, there's not much of it on show.
Question number two, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has considered all the implications of a border between an independent Scotland and England.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. The implication of independence is that Scotland will be both wealthier and fairer. On average, comparable independent countries to Scotland cited in the first paper in the updated independence prospectus have national incomes per head £14,000 greater than ours. As Mr. Bibby will be aware, the leader of the UK Labour Party has said, and I quote him, "Let me be very clear with Labour, Britain will not go back into the EU. We will not be joining the single market. We will not be joining a customs union." That is the bad news, but there is some better news. Keir Starmer has also pledged this. Labour would eliminate most border checks created by the Tory Brexit deal.
Point of order, Neil Bibby.
Point of order. There are standing orders, Presiding Officer. The members are meant to address the question that is put. I don't believe the Minister is addressing the question that I've asked, which was about the full implications of a border between independent Scotland. The answer seems to be about national incomes and various other things.
I would suggest that the member has his now supplementary, and perhaps will be able to tease out further information. Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Minister for that answer, which was not an answer to the question on the order paper that was put. The Scottish Government have asserted they will not be required to accept the Schengen Agreement, which the EU has been clear applies to any new state that wishes to enter the bloc, indicating their desire to continue being part of the British and Irish Common Travel Area. In order to make that work, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does this therefore mean that the Scottish Government have accepted that an independent Scotland would be required to align its immigration policies with the continuing United Kingdom?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I just suggest to Neil Bibby, if he wants to have full answers to questions, making points of order in the middle of ministers trying to answer them is probably not the best way to get answers. The best path for Scotland's future is to become independent, to rejoin the European Union, to manage our borders appropriately and escape the disastrous Brexit-based economy both Labour and the Tories are intent on inflicting the people of Scotland. I would ask Neil Bibby to reflect on the commitment by Sir Keir Starmer, who has pledged that Labour would eliminate most border checks created by the Tory Brexit deal. Is that a commitment or is it not?
Well, I think this is questions to the government, so I'm not entirely sure that for Mr. Bibby to answer in this context any questions. But moving on to the supplementary requested from Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Under the Common Travel Area, so this is a direct border question, Scotland will, like Ireland, retain freedom of movement across the British Isles and Ireland. This means that people like my constituents, living on one side of the border but working on the other, they will continue to be able to do so and they will be able to move freely between Scotland and England. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that this will be the case, and can he indicate whether he would expect the UK Government to try to mess with the CTA arrangements which predates the European Union?
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree entirely with what Emma Harper has said. Let's remember the reason it is Brexit that is creating borders. If the UK government takes a sensible approach to its relationship with the EU, many measures that we've talked about in our paper could be extremely minimal. Nobody sensible would argue that Scotland couldn't remain in the common travel area. Of course, I can't speak for the UK government, but this isn't just in Scotland's interest, but in the interests of everybody in the United Kingdom.
Question number 3, not lodged. I call question number 4, Elena Whittam.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any discussions with the UK Government in light of the concerns raised with the Secretary of State for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy regarding the retained EU law, revocation and reform bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
On the 11th of October, the Secretary of State for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy replied to my letter of the 5th of October, which outlined the Scottish Government's fundamental opposition to this bill. Our position remains that we would like to see the bill withdrawn or, at the very least, significantly changed in order for Scotland's interests and devolution generally to be protected. Mr Rees-Mogg's response did not alleviate our concerns of the bill, and my officials have been engaging weekly with UK government officials in charge of the bill to make clear the necessity of those changes, along with devolved government colleagues.
Elena Whittam.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, and I know he agrees with me that with the sunsetting of retained EU law by the 31st of December this year, we risk removing restrictions that currently protect holiday pay, safe limits of working hours and parental leave, and will become subject to amendment by the UK Government with an open ambition of deregulation. And this bill represents a significant undermining of devolution by allowing whatever government minister of the UK of the day to act in policy areas that are devolved. And importantly, without the consent of Scottish Minister or this Parliament, does he therefore agree with me that this is democratic deficit that Scotland faces is not a new phenomenon, and this is again more stark evidence, and what Scotland's people need right now is the choice to choose who they trust to navigate us out of this Brexit chaos?
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree with the member. Recent events demonstrate clearer than ever the democratic deficit that Scotland experiences under Westminster control. Using Brexit as a pretext to undermine the fundamental principles of devolution, the UK government has taken forward legislation without the consent of the Scottish Parliament on 7 occasions. It's taken powers to change devolved powers unilaterally through Westminster regulations made by UK ministers alone, and has rushed through without consent legislation constraining devolved competences and taking new powers to spend money for devolved purposes in Scotland. Under current arrangement, the UK House of Commons and the unelected House of Lords could change the powers of the Scottish Parliament or even abolish it at any time. And the opportunities of independence stand in stark contrast to the damage created by Brexit.
And supplementary, Stephanie Callaghan.
Presiding Officer, does the Minister agree with me that the so-called Brexit Freedoms Bill not only threatens our rights and the environment, but the unfettered nature of the bill will also act as an unwelcome intervention for Scotland's businesses, right at the time when they most need the economic security of good and stable governance?
I agree with the member. The legislation threatens to remove the rights and high standards, including standards of environmental protection, that the people of Scotland have become used to. This will allow legislation to be amended or sunsetted without the consultation and parliamentary scrutiny that good and stable governance requires. Added to this, the sunset date of 2023 introduces an entirely unrealistic timeframe that will force businesses to comply with new legislation while struggling with the consequences of COVID, the economic crisis, and the consequences of Brexit. That's why we've repeatedly called on the UK government to abandon this completely unnecessary and ideologically driven bill.
I call question number 5, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what steps are being taken to support the museum and gallery sector during the cost of living crisis.
Minister Neil Gray.
Officer, I thank Claire Baker for her question. I understand how deeply the sector has been affected by rising energy costs and the cost of living crisis, which has come just as they are trying to recover from the pandemic. The Scottish Government is in close communication with Museum Gallery Scotland to fully understand the challenges facing the museum and galleries sector, and as a result agreed that Museum Gallery Scotland should repurpose the grants it receives from the Scottish Government into a new resilience fund. This will support museums to build their resilience through activity that will reduce cost, increase income and support communities. And this new fund was announced on the 12th of October with an expression of interest deadline for the 17th of November.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. In evidence to the Culture Committee recently, the Cabinet Secretary spoke of museums and galleries providing warm spaces for communities, but they can only do that if they're able to remain open. I note that in response to Sarah Boyack earlier this week, the Minister advised that engagement was taking place with Creative Scotland to support organisations in the arts and culture sector who are facing immediate challenges. I do recognise he's spoken today about a new resilience fund, but is he confident the resilience fund will meet the needs of the sector, particularly those, you know, we know that the National Gallery has announced closures, the Film House has recently closed, there are threats across the country of venues being closed. Is he confident that money is enough to get them through this winter?
Minister.
I thank Clare Baker for her question, and just to be clear, we think it's a damning indictment on where we are within the UK, where energy-rich Scotland requires to have public buildings used for warmth sharing. It is a terrible situation that people are facing. Of course, we're continuing to engage with the culture sector around the extreme challenges that they face. We'll continue to do so. And obviously this highlights the folly, in my view, of the UK government cutting back on its COVID recovery funding before a meaningful recovery had actually taken place within the sector, and we're seeing the implications of that now. We're going to continue to work with the sector to do everything that we can to see the museums and gallery sector, as well as others across the cultural sector, to continue that recovery, but we cannot hide from the fact that we're facing an incredible, challenging period ahead.
Supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The impact of the cost of living crisis on our cultural sector was starkly highlighted when Aberdeen's iconic Belmont Cinema closed its doors. Weeks ago, the Scottish Government were warned what was coming and did nothing. The people of Aberdeen this morning heard accusations that there is a naivety about cinemas and the wider arts, and they were stunned to hear the Cabinet Secretary's bizarre claims in Iceland that all was going swimmingly. So, if the Minister genuinely does want to engage, will he join me and other local representatives in a formal meeting with the Belmont backers and Aberdeen City Council to thrash out a rescue for the Belmont?
Minister, obviously we're straying to the wider cultural sector here, but presumably the Minister would be happy to respond to the point that Mr Kerr made.
Yes, thank you, President Officer. I thank Liam Kerr for bringing this issue up. It's not true. His characterisation of government action is not true, first of all. But secondly, and I have to be careful what I say with regards to CMI, because obviously there are legal matters going on in terms of the administration process that is going there. However, I can give him the guarantee that both government colleagues, Creative Scotland, Screen Scotland colleagues are working very hard to try to find a solution. I'd be more than happy to meet with Liam Kerr within the confines of those legal parameters of which I speak, but obviously we want in all scenarios to see these important cultural institutions continue to thrive. We know the significance of the Belmont in Aberdeen, not just in terms of from its cultural perspective, but from an economic perspective as well. The same with the Film House here in Edinburgh. And we will do everything that we can to ensure that we can protect those institutions as best as possible. Though I have to say, his colleagues in London, who I presume he still supports, would wish to look at this from a UK-wide perspective, because these are not issues that are isolated just to Scotland. This is a UK-wide issue, and his government has a responsibility to stop austerity and to ensure that our cultural centres are properly supported.
And supplementary, Alistair Allen.
During what he's acknowledged to be an anxious time for many in the museums and galleries sector, does the Minister agree that these issues are compounded for many smaller museums and galleries in particular, given the Tories' cruel and reckless austerity policies, which mean, presumably, fewer people have the means to visit a gallery in the first place?
Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that. There is a very challenging set of scenarios, that's a scenario facing our cultural institutions right now, which is rising energy costs, rising inflation, of which the UK government has a clear responsibility, and its actions actually have made the problems worse in recent weeks. But also the money in people's pockets as a result, meaning that their spending power in the local economy is reduced. So it's a very challenging situation, one that we are going to do what we can within our resources to respond to as best as possible. But there is no doubt that the UK government has a clear responsibility here to ensure that they are supporting cultural institutions, which then has a knock-on impact on the finances that we have in order to respond to their crisis too.
Question number 6, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its international work following the Constitution Secretary's attendance at the recent Arctic Circle Assembly.
Cabinet Secretary.
Government continues to engage with international partners to encourage cultural, economic and policy collaboration that attract investment and create domestic opportunities for people in Scotland. My visit to Iceland for the Arctic Circle Assembly allowed me to promote Scotland's expertise in relation to challenges and ambitions that we share with our Arctic neighbours, including in relation to decarbonisation, energy solutions and rural well-being. It was hugely worthwhile to attend the Assembly to present an update on the Scottish Government's Arctic cooperation and holding bilateral meetings with the Prime Minister and Foreign Minister of Iceland, ministers from Greenland, the Faroe Islands, Canada and Singapore, delegates from the United States, Norway, Japan, and hosting the largest ever contingent from Scotland. And may I put on record my appreciation to President Ólafur Ragnar Grímsson for organising the Arctic Circle Assembly.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. And given changing international security threats globally due to Russia's war in Ukraine and increases to maritime routes in the Arctic Circle because of warming seas, does the Cabinet Secretary agree that there must be consideration of new maritime security threats to the Norwegian Sea and the North Sea? And will this be a matter of focus alongside our Arctic Circle-related climate commitments with our partners in the new Nordic Office?
Cabinet Secretary.
The exponential pace at which the Arctic region is warming is a matter of deep concern. As one of the first countries in the world to declare a climate emergency, we recognise the vital importance of taking immediate action domestically and encourage ambitious measures internationally. The Scottish Government is fully aware of Scotland's key geostrategic position as the world's most northerly non-Arctic nation. And as new shipping routes become viable, we are ideally located and have clear credentials to become a subarctic maritime transport and logistics hub. But receding sea ice in the Arctic creates threats as well, which we must be alert to, and at a time when the Arctic is the focus of renewed geopolitical and security considerations, it's crucial that we develop a full understanding of the threats that our communities and critical infrastructure could face.
Question number 7, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government what activities it plans to hold to commemorate 800 years since Dumbarton became a royal borough.
Cabinet Secretary.
I hope the member is pleased when I say that the Scottish Government recognises the significance of the 800th anniversary of Dumbarton becoming a royal borough. Being able to connect with local history is important for the health and well-being of Scotland's communities as well as our national identity. I'm pleased that this year's Rock of Ages event, themed for Dumbarton 800, was such a successful part of the official celebrations. Historic Environment Scotland, who worked on that project with the anniversary organisers, are happy to explore future events with West Dumbartonshire Council and the community.
Jackie Bailey.
I'll take it from that response that there is nothing going on now. I've written to the Cabinet Secretary about this before. Dumbarton Castle is closed, it's covered in scaffolding. The Rock of Ages event had its second day cancelled due to the weather, and 800 years celebration announced amounted to a tannoy announcement. This is a hugely significant event for any town, but the Scottish Government don't appear to want to celebrate it. So I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary does not wish to imply that there is any snub to the good people of Dumbarton. So let me give him another chance. What will he do?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm pleased that the inspection of Dumbarton Castle is now complete. I understand that Historic Environment Scotland is preparing a technical report ahead of the November community engagement event, which I understand the member and the chief executive of Historic Environment Scotland are attending. This review will result in decisions being made around the opening or partial opening of the site, and any repair works identified will be scheduled into the wider high-level masonry repair programme.
Question number 8, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any discussions it has had with the Scottish Events Campus in Glasgow regarding capital investment in the facility.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Due to emerging budgetary pressures, of which I have already spoken, and the reassessment of budget priorities as set out in the resource spending review, we are unable to commit to support via a capital finance package for the expansion of the conference centre. There have been, therefore, no specific discussions on capital investment at the SEC since the Cabinet Secretary met with Peter Duthie on the 27th of April. We continue to engage with the SEC and others on how the National Event Strategy Review can build on the industry's success and deliver on government priorities.
Paul Sweeney.
I must say it's a disappointing response from the government. Investment in SEC expansion is critical for Glasgow's economy, with campus activity seeding footfall in local hospitality venues, increasing taxi and transport demand, and supporting businesses across the region. I previously asked the Cabinet Secretary if the government would support that capital financing, but he had indicated that that discussion had been paused with the SEC management. So this is the time for progressing, not pausing investment in Glasgow, lest we see further decline in Glasgow's economy, and most recently marked by the failure to secure the Eurovision contest. Will the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister therefore reconsider their decision to pause these discussions in the interest of stimulating Glasgow's economy, ensuring we get economic growth, and securing the international competitiveness of the SEC for conferences and major events?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Minister. And I thank Paul Sweeney for his question. I absolutely agree with him, the importance that the SEC plays, not just in the Glasgow economy, but the overall Scottish economy as well. It's clearly very important. I was very sad personally, given the limited involvement that I had in Glasgow's bid, that we were very supportive of, that Eurovision isn't taking place there. We absolutely recognise the importance of the SEC. Unfortunately, our budgetary situation is such that very difficult decisions have had to be taken. We'll continue to have discussions with the SEC, others across the national, the major events sector through the review, and I would encourage Mr Sweeney to engage in that so that his interests can be put forward and that of the constituents that he represents.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, and we will now move on to the next portfolio, which is Justice and Veterans. And I would remind members that questions 2 and 7 are grouped together and that therefore I will take any supplementaries on these questions once both questions have been answered. If a member wishes to request a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question, and they should indicate so if online in the chat function by entering the letter R. And again, I would make a plea for succinct questions and answers in order to get in as many members as possible. I call question number 1, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to support women in custody reintegrate back into their communities.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
The Scottish Government and Scottish Prison Service are committed to ensuring that women leaving custody receive the support they need to reintegrate successfully. The new female estate, including 2 innovative community custody units, supports that commitment, underpinned by a revised strategy for women in custody, which is gender-specific and trauma-informed. The CCUs support a change to rehabilitation of women in custody, linking them to local services and preparing them for their eventual return to the community. And we also provide £1.4 million per year to fund the national Shine Third Sector Partnership, which provides support to women leaving custody and remand.
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. It's important that we acknowledge that recidivism is also a risk amongst those who have offended and spent time in custody. What steps is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that women released from custody do not end up back in custody again?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sure the member appreciates that there's not one specific step on its own that can prevent reoffending or indeed to help an individual reintegrate into the community successfully. There needs to be an holistic approach across justice services and our wider public services. First of all, though, it is important to recognise that short custodial sentences are less successful at reducing reoffending, so the presumption against short sentences and the continuing development of bail supervision is helping to prevent women being taken into custody unless absolutely necessary. And as I've said, the SPS has established a new strategy for women in custody that will take support for the development of women's agency through opportunities to make choices. All plans, interventions and approaches and activities will be based on sound evidence and designed to boost the factors known to promote desistance from crime and improve life chances.
And supplementary, Katie Clark.
What discussions has there been with domestic abuse specialists about the engagement with women being released from custody?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's been substantial discussions with the specialists and also the organisations which are most closely involved in that sector, and the member will know the organisations that I'm referring to. But over and above that, when SPS looked towards establishing these two units, they have taken into account international, academic and the best possible advice as to how to properly affect rehabilitation. They are unique. There's only two of these in the UK. They are both in Scotland. They represent, in my view, the way forward, and it will allow women to reintegrate back into society in a much more effective way, and a way in which, of course, we can reduce future crime. So I hope they will have the support of all members in the chamber.
Question number two, Paul McLennan.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps have been taken to ensure that retailers are aware of and comply with the measures in the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Article Scotland Act 2022 that came into effect on the 10th of October.
Cabinet Secretary.
Measures commenced this month which will enhance community safety over the fireworks season, and as part of the implementation of those measures, the Scottish Government has engaged and shared guidance with the Scottish Retail Consortium, the Scottish Grocers Federation, supermarkets and industry representative bodies. The importance of involving retailers during the rollout of new measures in the Act is recognised. And additionally, the Scottish Government is funding trading standards to undertake a fireworks enforcement project with retailers. And that follows on from a similar project last year to support the implementation of new regulations, and involves engaging with retailers on measures being introduced through the Act, as well as reinforcing existing legislation.
Paul McLennan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I'm glad to hear about the joint working between the Scottish Government and retailers to ensure compliance with the new measures. Can I ask what steps the Scottish Government have taken to ensure wider public awareness across the country of the impact that fireworks can have on people, animals, and to raise awareness of the new measures commenced earlier this month?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm pleased to advise the member that the Scottish Government, again with our partners, has once again launched the three public awareness raising campaigns to promote the safe and responsible use of fireworks. Key information on the new proxy purchase offence has been integrated into each of the campaigns to ensure people are aware of this new offence. We have also worked with our stakeholders, including Police Scotland, to share messages across our social media channels on the new statutory aggravation for attacks against emergency workers using fireworks. And the campaigns run in partnership with partners including the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, Crime Stoppers and Trading Standards to promote the safe and responsible use of fireworks, and also to cover a wide range of media, including social media, radio, as well as posters and leaflets in retail outlets selling fireworks.
I call question number 7, Gillian Martin.
To ask the Scottish Government how the Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Article Scotland Act 2022 will make this year's bonfire night safer for our communities.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would highlight the two key provisions to the member which came into effect this month. One makes it an offence for adults to purchase fireworks on behalf of or make these available to under-18s to strengthen the protection of young people and communities. And the other provision relates to a statutory aggravation for courts sentencing where fireworks were used to attack emergency workers. This clearly signals that such vile behaviour will be firmly addressed. And to share the public safety message with communities, our awareness-raising campaigns have been updated, and the Scottish Government is working alongside a range of partners, including Police Scotland and the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, to actively engage and prepare ahead of Bonfire Night.
Julian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's great to hear of movement in this area. It's something that I get an awful lot of correspondence about in my constituency. And I welcome our support for emergency services as they face aggravated attacks during this period. I'd like to ask the Cabinet Secretary to join me in condemning the attacks ahead of Bonfire Night. And I also want to ask what aspects of the provisions of the bill will be rolled out in time for next year's Bonfire Night celebrations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, I think we've demonstrated that we are committed to progressing positive change for communities by acting as swiftly as possible. And I'd like to reassure the member that this approach will continue as we implement the remaining measures within the Act, as she's asked. But I would, I think, very importantly, join the member in condemning the attacks against our hard-working emergency service workers in the strongest possible terms. These are people that we rely on in very extreme circumstances very often. It seems unacceptable, it seems actually incomprehensible that a minority choose to act in this vile manner towards those who are dedicated to keeping our communities and each and every one of us safe. The member will know, of course, there are already specific laws in place to protect emergency workers. But I hope that the new statutory aggravation for offences involving attacks using fireworks against them provides reassurance that this Government is committed to such cases being dealt with robustly, with penalties that reflect the serious nature of such offending. And I would like to take the opportunity to thank our emergency workers, all of our partners, for the vast amount of work undertaken in preparation for Bonfire Night. And I would commit to write to the member with more information about the implementation timetable for the other parts of the Act.
A supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thank you. Can I first of all thank the Government for accepting my amendment, including that aggravator in the fireworks bill? It's an important message to send to the public. But also during the passage of the bill, the Government said that there was little evidence to suggest that the bill would lead to an increase in black market activity. Last week, trading standard officers in Glasgow confiscated 250 fireworks from a barbershop in the city, poorly stored and clearly putting lives at danger. Wasn't that assessment of the black market during that bill somewhat naive given this context? And what is the Government doing to ensure that they are cracking down on the potential of a real potential growth in the black market and firework sales?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think I've outlined some of the actions that we are taking with the partners that we have, whether it's through trading standards, Police Scotland and others, to make sure we do this. I don't think it's possible to say at this stage, you know, in the very early stages of this Act being implemented, that that does prove that there's been a wrongful assessment of the black market activity. I'm aware of the case that Jamie Green talks about, of course, and we condemn it, but I think we do have to wait to see how this works out over a period of time. As I said, a lot of the public awareness raising is going on just now. That will continue and be built upon in future years, and hopefully that drives out and makes much more socially unacceptable the kind of black market activities which Jamie Green refers to.
I call question number 3, Graeme Day.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it can take to support armed forces and veterans families in Scotland during the cost of living crisis, in light of recent reports that almost 3,000 serving military personnel in the UK are reliant on universal credit.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is undertaking an emergency budget review to assess all opportunities to redirect additional resources to those most in need and to reduce the burdens on business and stimulate the Scottish economy. There is also further support available to the Armed Forces community, and I know that the Member will be aware, given how instrumental he was in making sure this happened, which includes the £500,000 provided annually through the Scottish Veterans Fund, which launched earlier this month. And that, this year, that fund prioritises projects which offer support to those affected by the cost of living crisis. And, of course, we will continue to engage with stakeholders across the community more widely to develop our response.
Graeme Day.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer, but of course it's not just the fact that nearly 3,000 serving personnel are having to turn to universal credit to get by that betrays the Tories' contempt for our armed forces. There are also issues with the standard of accommodation provided them. RM Condor in my constituency has long been the subject of commentary on the quality of accommodation available to the Marines there, and contrary to recent media reports, I understand there are no plans on the part of the MOD to address this. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it is long past time we saw proper investment in the accommodation element of military facilities in Scotland to bring them up to an acceptable standard?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I quite agree with the member. The Scottish Government recognises the dedication of the men and women who are willing to serve their country, and that they themselves and their families rightly deserve quality accommodation that meets their needs. They have a budget of £48 billion in the MOD, and they're failing to meet the responsibility to address this matter. It's also true to say, of course, that around 3,000 serving personnel in Scotland accessing universal credit will come as a shock to many people in Scotland, or the 38,000 figure is for the rest of the UK. Armed Forces personnel having to draw down on universal credit. It's absolutely right to say this is a scandal. It's also true to say, of course, in Scotland we have at least the 19 pence tax, which makes sure that people in Scotland and the Armed Forces at that level pay less tax than they do in the rest of the UK, to add to the fact, of course, that most people in Scotland pay less tax than people in the rest of the UK do. But that is a scandal. And if they want to seriously address the issues of recruitment and retention and respect for Armed Forces, you should pay proper wages. In terms of the accommodation, the member will know I'm very familiar with the base that he talks about. And similarly, the personnel that we have on that base deserve proper, decent accommodation, and the MOD should address that as soon as possible.
I call question number 4, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the provision of community policing, including community safety patrols, in the South Scotland region.
Cabinet Secretary.
The member will know that the deployment of police resources, including community patrols, is a matter for Police Scotland, and they work closely with local authorities on preventing and tackling a range of issues, including antisocial behaviour within their geographical areas. However, supporting Police Scotland to keep communities safe remains a priority for the Government, and policing services have been maintained and improved, and we've invested over £10 billion in policing since the creation of the single service in 2013.
Emma Harper.
thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. At my recent surgery in Summerhill in Dumfries, I heard concerns from local residents about what they believe to be increased levels of antisocial behaviour in that area. We know that engagement and education are the best ways to prevent crime and antisocial behaviour happening in the first place, and I've called for a multi-agency meeting with the police, the Housing Authority and Community Safety Team to address constituents' concerns. But can the Cabinet Secretary comment on how the Scottish Government is supporting the police and the community safety, and can he urge them to engage with me and the local residents on these matters?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, the Scottish Government recognises, of course, that everyone has the right to be and to feel safe in their own communities, and that's why we're committed to tackling all forms of antisocial behaviour. And Police Scotland and local authorities lead on interventions and have a range of options available when tackling antisocial behaviour. We recognise, of course, that no single approach will tackle all antisocial behaviour, which is why we support a suite of activities which includes, of course, antisocial behaviour orders, fixed penalty notices, alongside diversionary and early intervention activities. I was heavily involved in this area when I was a council leader myself, and I know there can be different approaches in different local authority areas. But for our part, we are committed to ensuring all agencies have the powers and resources needed, and that we ourselves, and I'm sure the police, are always willing to discuss any changes that could improve prevention and also to respond to antisocial behaviour with all relevant bodies.
I call question number 5, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will consider additional measures to deal with the reported increase in antisocial behaviour, including in the bus network.
Cabinet Secretary.
As I mentioned in the previous answer, everyone has the right to be and to feel safe in their community, or indeed when using public transport. And reported antisocial behaviour has broadly been in decline over the last decade. But we know that where issues arise, these can have a very serious impact for many people in our communities. That is why we continue to support the activity that we undertake to prevent it wherever it occurs. As I mentioned already, no single approach will tackle all antisocial behaviour, and that's why we continue to ensure that partners can call on a range of measures, including the ones I've mentioned, such as antisocial behaviour orders and fixed penalty notices, as well as diversionary and preventative activities. I fully support Police Scotland in their attempts to take appropriate and proportionate actions in response to reported incidents, and also fully support their continued work in partnership with transport operators and local authorities to continue to make public transport safe for both passengers and staff.
Willie Coffey.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. He will be aware of local antisocial incidents, some extremely serious, occurring recently in Kilmarnock, both on the bus network and bus station, resulting in the station being closed. Can I ask the Minister, what can you do to help tackle this problem and, if necessary, liaise with other portfolios within government to ensure that the public can travel in safety?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I can confirm to the member I am aware of the incident that he refers to and was shocked by it, the incident in Kilmarnock. And also would add that my thoughts are with the young man and his family at what must be an exceptionally difficult time for them. The member will appreciate it's not appropriate for me to comment on a live case, but I do understand Police Scotland are treating this as an isolated incident and they are maintaining a strong presence in and around the town centre. I'm also aware of the issues in East Ayrshire that have involved the bus network and the bus station, and share the concerns that this must be causing both the member but his constituents as well. It's of course essential that all passengers are able to travel safely, and we have been liaising with Police Scotland and the local authority, and I understand that an extensive partnership response is being deployed at local level, led by a multi-agency resilience group involving a range of partners, including the council, education, police and transport authorities, to address and tackle this unacceptable behaviour. The Scottish Government is, of course, open to considering all options for tackling antisocial behaviour. I'll raise this with those responsible for the bus pass scheme, for example, to gather views on whether the option that's been mentioned elsewhere on whether withdrawal of bus passes might present some kind of a solution, to gather views. But I'm also clear that those who have been involved in the antisocial behaviour represent a very small number of individuals. And we're absolutely clear that such incidents are not an indictment of the bus pass scheme as a whole. The scheme has and will continue to deliver many positive outcomes for people across Scotland.
And supplementary, Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Glasgow Chamber of Commerce has warned that free bus travel for under 22s is, quote, certainly not helping with antisocial behaviour. And there are reports of youth using buses to engage in violence and other criminality. Now, in light of today's stark and unprecedented budget warnings from Police Scotland, what reassurances can the Cabinet Secretary give to to the public?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think I mentioned a number of ways in which the partnership working, which I think is very important to this, whether it's Glasgow or Kilmarnock, will be followed through. But in relation to the budget situation, it's worth just remembering a couple of facts, which, of course, people in Scotland are substantially less likely to experience crime than they were in 2007. There are far more police officers now than there were when we came into office in 2007. The officers within Scotland are paid £5,000 a year more than their counterparts in England and Wales. And also, we've seen very recently an all-time low record in terms of crime, down to 1970s levels when records were first began. As well as yesterday, of course, seeing the lowest ever recorded number of homicides. It would be nice on occasion to hear one or two good things said about the police by the Conservative benches. Unfortunately, once again, not happening today, but the rest of us will make sure that we give due credit to the police.
Question number 6, Joe Fitzpatrick.
Ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the trafficking and exploitation strategy.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, any form of human trafficking or exploitation is completely unacceptable, and the Government continues to work closely with partners to tackle this horrific crime. The 5th annual report on our trafficking and exploitation strategy is due for publication in early 2023. We also marked Anti-Slavery Day on the 18th of October by initiating a review of the strategy, beginning with the launch of a public survey on trafficking and exploitation in Scotland, running until mid-December. Responses will shape the review alongside engagement with partners across the strategy's main action areas of identifying victims, disrupting perpetrators and addressing the underlying causes of exploitation.
Cabinet Secretary,
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. A recent operation in Dundee has brought modern slavery charges against two men, with investigators saying that this could just be the tip of the iceberg, as highlighted by Alistair Clark in the Courier. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what support the Scottish Government is providing Police Scotland to deal with this specialised area of criminal investigation and ensure that victims are provided with the necessary support?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would say to the member there's been work done on this now over a number of years, including, I think, two law and advocates ago, to make sure that as much protection as possible can be provided to the victims. But we are clear that commercial sexual exploitation, of which prostitution is one aspect, is a form of gendered violence, and support our law enforcement agencies and third sector support agencies in working together to address it. The victim-centred approach fund includes significantly increased funding for support organisations. TARA and Migrant Help will share over £6.35 million over the next 3 years to provide support and assistance to adult victims of trafficking and exploitation. And we're also providing over £900,000 to other support organisations, providing support to those recovering from this horrific crime. And I would advise the member that the Minister for Community Safety met with key partners in Aberdeen yesterday to learn more about their approach to helping support individuals involved in prostitution with often complex underlying issues in order to reduce their vulnerability.
And question number 8, Rosa Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the steps it is taking to tackle violence against women.
Cabinet Secretary.
In June 2022, a refresh of the Equally Safe Delivery Plan was published, outlining the joint commitment of the Scottish Government and COSLA to preventing and eradicating all forms of violence against women and girls and tackling the underpinning attitudes that perpetuate it. Through the Justice Portfolio and the Victim-Centred Approach Fund, we've invested £18.5 million in specialist advocacy support for survivors of gender-based violence, and the Delivering Equally Safe Fund is providing £90 million per year to support projects that are focused on early intervention and support. And it's only through fundamental societal change, of course, that women can be fully protected.
Rosa Grant.
Commercial sexual exploitation is recognised by the Scottish Government as violence against women, and indeed has been for many years. And while we've had legislation on almost every other aspect of violence against women, which is very welcome, commercial sexual exploitation has had no legislation to combat the harm it causes. Can I ask when the Scottish Government will bring forward such legislation?
Cabinet Secretary.
The bill, which has been referred to previously, the Criminal Justice Reform Bill and a programme of government, will aim to improve the experience of victims in the justice system, and it will help deliver reforms building on the recent consultation on improving victims' experience of the justice system. And also, the member will be aware that the recommendations from Lady Dorian's review on improving the management of sexual offence cases will also be addressed, and that will include proposals to introduce, for example, a statutory right to anonymity for complainers in sexual offence cases. And on a related matter, the member will know, of course, that we intend to abolish the not proven verdict. So this and a number of other work streams which the Minister is involved with will continue. And, of course, if there's a possibility of further legislation, that will be considered also.
A supplementary, Katie Clark.
Thank you. And I refer to my entry in the Register of Members' Interests. In a debate on booking office closures and staffing levels on the railways, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport committed to a review of women's safety on public transport. Will the Cabinet Secretary ensure that his department feed into this review, and what measures are needed to help prevent, deal with antisocial behaviour and violence against women on public transport?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can tell the member I've had preliminary discussions with the Minister responsible, and of course the member will be aware the link there would be with British Transport Police, which she's quite right is a justice function. So happy to continue to engage with the Minister to see how we can make sure, and it relates back to previous questions as well, how we can make sure that women and girls and everybody is safe on public transport.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on justice and veterans. I will allow a short pause to allow frontbench teams to move position. Thank you.